Christ my highest heaven adored, Christ the everlasting Lord. Late in time behold him come, offspring of the virgin's womb. Veiled in flesh the Godhead see, hail the incarnate deity. With us to dwell, Jesus our Emmanuel. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Hail the heaven-born Prince of Peace, hail the Son of Righteousness. Light and life all he brings, risen with healing in his wings. Mild he lays his glory by, born that we no more may die. Born to raise us from the earth, born to give a second birth. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King.
You may be seated. And at this time, we will invite the Hicks family forward for the lighting of the Advent wreath and the candle of love. Number two.
Hicks.
Thank you.
Today we light the first, second, third, and fourth candles of the Advent wreath. Each candle has a meaning. The first candle is hope, the second candle is peace, the third candle is joy, and the fourth candle is love.
We hear in John 13, Jesus said to them, I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. Let us pray. Loving God, your mercy and compassion endure forever. Open our hearts that we may receive your love, and following the example of your Son, spread that love to a love-starved world. Through Jesus Christ, who loved us to the end. Amen.
Amen. Living God, love incarnate, we confess that we are not perfect. You who are everything, we acknowledge that we are lacking. Child of the manger, we admit that we prefer to be sentimental rather than sacrificial. Hear us now as we confess our faults and admit our frailties. Let us pray. O God, we eagerly await the true light that is coming into the world. But we are easily distracted by the twinkly lights all around us. We plan to spend more time this season in study and prayer, cultivating our interior life with you. But we got distracted by the season's social demands. Stir up your might and share us with our complacency. that we might remember the reason for the season. A child sent to bring us light and love. A child sent to save us. Amen. Let us sing, O Little Town of Bethlehem, 1 and 4. God is with us because God loves us. God has always loved us. Rest in this knowledge. God came to save us, and God is with us. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Our first reading is from Isaiah. Chapter 7, verses 10 through 16. Later, the Lord sent this message to King Ahaz. Ask the Lord your God for a sign of confirmation, Ahaz. Make it as difficult as you want, as high as heaven or as deep as the place of the dead. But the king refused. No, he said, I will not test the Lord like that. Then Isaiah said, Listen well, you royal family of David. Isn't it enough to exhaust human patience? Must you exhaust the patience of my God as well? All right then, the Lord himself will give you the sign. Look, the virgin will conceive a child. She will give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel, which means God is with us. By the time this child is old enough to choose what is right and reject what is wrong, he will be eating yogurt and honey. For before the child is that old, the lands of the two kings you fear so much will both be deserted. Our second reading is from Psalm 80, verses 1 through 7, and verses 17 through 19. Please listen, O shepherd of Israel, you who lead Joseph's descendants like a flock. O God, enthroned above the cherubim, display your radiant glory to Ephraim, Benjamin, and Manasseh. Show us your mighty power. Come to rescue us. Turn us again to yourself, O God. Make your face shine down upon us. Only then will we be saved. O Lord God of heaven's armies, how long will you be angry with our prayers? You have fed us with sorrow and made us drink tears by the bucketful. You have made us the scorn of neighboring nations. Our enemies treat us as a joke. Turn us again to yourself, O God of heaven's armies. Make your face shine down upon us. Only then will we be saved. Strengthen the man you love, the son of your choice. Then we will never abandon you again. Revive us so we can call on your name once more. Turn us again to yourself, O Lord God of heaven's armies. Make your face shine down upon us. Only then will we be saved. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Well, this morning our response is going to be a little different. We are going to do the congregational bells, and Kay is going to give us some direction. So find those bells. If you're, you might have to. Okay, they found them. It's like elementary school. It's like, you know, when you teach school, you don't hand out papers until you've given the instruction. No. Do we have enough bells?
If there's a bell that's free, somebody grab it. Because I put them on every pew.
Not everybody's got one?
Every pew. So look around and see if there's an extra bell.
You got a bell? You got a bell? You got a bell? You got a bell? There you go. Need one?
All right, the way to do this is you read by color. So if you see this red one with the black in it, that's a C1. If there's a red that's up on the top, that's a C8. It won't have the black in it. It really doesn't matter. If you want to bring the red both times, go ahead. It's all in the same chord, so it doesn't matter. So I'm gonna do this and quickly change them. So when I change the card, new bells will ring. It goes through the song twice. So if you have a bell the first time, share it with your neighbor the second time through. I'll tell you when we're gonna start.
Participate, okay? Marcia.
All right, we'll give this a try.
Number 10.
Let me start that again.
Okay, good. I'm going to listen.
I guess we don't need that on.
Put your bells down and don't touch them for the rest of the service. Turn and greet one another with the peace and love of Jesus Christ.
Bethlehem's cries. See, all heaven has come to proclaim it. Hear how their song of joy arises. Love, love, born unto you, a Savior. Love, love, glory to God on high. Love is born, come share in the wonder. Love is God, now asleep in the hay. See the glow in the eyes of his mother. What is the name? Her heart is saying love, love. Love is the name, she whispers love, love, Jesus Emmanuel. Love has come and never will leave us. Love is life everlasting and free. Love is Jesus within and among us. Love is the peace our hearts are seeking. Love, love, love is the gift of Christmas. Love, love, praise to you, God on high.
God, love is with us. Emmanuel, let us receive this morning's offering. Shepherd of Israel, you have led us like a flock into the pastures of your grace and mercy. In thankfulness and praise for the child born to us at Christmas, receive the gifts of our tithes and offerings. Receive our hearts also, that we may share your love with the world. Amen. We have just one pink slip before us. Perhaps there are other joys or concerns to raise. Please pray for a safe trip for Arvilla and Dave Wilson as they travel to Virginia for Christmas. And so we lift you in our prayers for traveling mercies. We also need to lift up the Mullen family in their time of loss. Ann Mullen passed away this morning, just after midnight at Clifton Springs Hospital after experiencing an aneurysm. Early yesterday afternoon. And so the family will be meeting with the Cheney Funeral Home, and I understand that there will be no services this week. It'll be sometime after the Christmas holiday. That's Ted's request. So please keep Ted and Piper and Renee and the extended family in your prayers at this time. We also need to continue our prayers for Irene Copper. I visited with her this past week, and although she's in good spirits, I think she'd much rather be anywhere else than there. But she promised me that she would be doing her rehab and so that she can get home that much faster. Any other updates, Rose? Okay, couple months. So let us pray for Irene's peace and comfort as well. Are there other names, Frank?
On Saturday, December 10th, Devin participated in all county auditions. He auditioned for both all county jazz and all county orchestra. He was selected as first trombone for both.
Wonderful.
What do you know he won? He won an orchestra with the jazz group recruited to play jazz.
Okay, wonderful. Congratulations, Devin. Congratulations. Good stuff. We need to thank Doris and Kathy, and I suspect their spouses, for decorating our chancel area with our Christmas flowers. And you'll find in your bulletin this morning who they are in memory and in honor of. So take a glance at that when you have a moment, and thank you for doing that for us. It really helps us in this season of Christmas and Advent. Dan?
I would like to say on behalf of all of us at the Phelps Lions Club, we at the Christmas Joy Saturday, Friday and Saturday, packing up all of the baskets for the needy in Phelps and the people of this church were absolutely awesome. If you had just had the pleasure of seeing everything that was donated, and you guys don't get to see the pleasure on the faces of people who really need it, and the tears of joy that really happens when the Boy Scouts deliver, when we deliver, and it just makes Christmas fantastic. Thank you. Thank you, guys.
Some year you should do like a ride-along so we can see those smiles. That'd be a lot of fun. Thank you to the Lions Club, Mission Team, and this congregation for meeting that need again. Anyone else?
Oh,
okay.
When we're done with worship today, if you have a bell, would you put it back in its plastic bag and just bring it up here in the front pew, and I'll put them away. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Let us turn our hearts and our minds in prayer to our God. Gracious and loving God, thank you for this season of Advent, the season that helps us to slow down in the midst of all that is rush and hurry. This Advent season reminds us that the hope that we need in our world and in our lives comes at Christmas. The peace that our world needs and our hearts need come at Christmas. The joy that we desire comes at Christmas. and the love that we so desperately desire comes at Christmas. And in just a few days, we will celebrate the light that comes into our world. A light in which the darkness cannot blow out. How grateful we are for these gifts. These gifts that help to sustain us each and every day of our lives. These gifts that make it just that much easier to confess our sin and our shortcoming, knowing that you, Emmanuel, God, you are with us to give us peace and love and forgiveness. Thank you, O God, for giving us these Sundays to prepare our hearts for your arrival. Thank you, O God, for hearing us when we pray. And there are those in our families and within this family, this congregation, that need your hope, peace, love, and joy. They need your light. Particularly this morning, the Mullen Mobley family. We ask, O God, that your peace would comfort them. That your hope would remind them that this is not the end. That there is more. Be with Ted and Piper and Renee. Lead them through this time, O God, this valley. Be with Irene as she recovers and recoups at Clifton Springs Hospital. May she sense your comfort and the prayers of her family and friends. We celebrate with Devin on being selected to be a part of All County. Thank you for his gift and talent and that he chooses to share that with this church and community. Oh God, we ask for your blessing upon all of us. Help us to welcome you. Help us to anticipate your arrival. And help us to share the good news long after Christmas has come and gone. Hear us now, O God, as a faith community. Pray as we've been taught to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Our gospel lesson this morning is the story of Christmas, the birth of Jesus, our Messiah, and it comes to us from Matthew's gospel, the story that's a little less, not as well known as Luke's story, but you'll hear the Christmas story in these words. Matthew chapter 1, beginning with the 18th verse. Now the birth of Jesus, the Messiah, took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been engaged to Joseph, but before they lived together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. Her husband Joseph, being a righteous man and unwilling to expose her to public disgrace, planned to dismiss her quietly. But just when he had resolved to do this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet. "Look, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall name him Emmanuel," which means God is with us. When Joseph awoke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took her as his wife. They had no marital relations until she had borne a son, and he named him Jesus. This is the word of God for the people of God. The minute our Thanksgiving turkeys are cooked, carved, and eaten, the radios in our homes, cars, and shopping malls change over quickly to 24-hour Christmas music. Churches all over this land are transformed into places of great expectation, and because there are only so many truly Advent songs in our hymnals that are at least singable, and because we don't want to sing, "Come thou long expected Jesus," over and over and over again, even we in the life of the church tap into our favorite Christmas carols a little early. This year, I was particularly aware of the music all around me for some reason or other, probably because Gabriel has insisted on watching Caillou's Christmas movie 49,000 times. No exaggeration there. And of course, as Christmas nears, all those songs and carols that we have all grown up with, they just simply pop into our minds and we begin to sing them and hum them throughout the day. "Angels we have heard on high, sweetly singing o'er the plain. Away in a manger, no crib for his bed. O Tannenbaum, O Tannenbaum, how lovely are your branches. All I want for Christmas is my two front teeth, my two front teeth, my two front teeth. I saw Mommy kissing Santa Claus underneath the mistletoe last night." All of the music, in the midst of all of my to-ing and fro-ing this season, made me remember a sermon title from a few years ago, "All I Want for Christmas is a Nap." And likely without all of the wonderful music we know, all of the Advent preparations and the hope of this season to keep you and me going, I think I would have been fast asleep about 10 days ago. I mean, it's true, right, that Christmas is a time of tremendous expectations, and there's a way in which all that shopping and cleaning and cooking and wrapping and visiting one another can take more out of us than all of that seems to put back into us. Sometimes in this season we call Christmas, it's the long winter's nap and that vision of children all nestled and snuggled in their beds that we long for the most. Because expectations can be terribly exhausting. And I think that's in part why the season of Advent, these 4 weeks that lead up to Christmas, seem so countercultural, full of countercultural potential. They imagine such a different way of preparing for the birth of Jesus, our Savior, the one that cannot be rushed, the one that cannot be shoehorned in between trips to Eastview Marketplace, the Outlet Mall, Grease Ridge, you name it, Walmart, Home Depot. The time comes when it comes. And it's going to unfold as it unfolds. And it becomes an invitation for each one of us to stop. Stop for a minute. Stop rushing. And for something within each one of us to unfold. And I know it's so foreign to our way of living and doing things. So foreign to so many of our expectations. So many of us demand a whole lot of Christmas and demand a whole lot of ourselves at Christmas. And yet, as today's scripture reminds us, the story of Christmas, the story of the birth of the Christ child, is precisely about the arrival of something foreign to our expectations and foreign to our familiar way of life. It's a story about learning a whole new set of rules and about learning to see the world with fresh and new eyes. After all, the old rules were utterly clear. They were utterly clear about what happened next when you found that the young girl to whom you had been betrothed was already, quote, with child. The ancient world was immensely serious about this betrothal. This ancient engagement was much, much more binding than our engagements are today. In fact, legally speaking, you were already considered bound to one another, and there really was no easy way to be, well, unbound. And in the Hebrew scriptures, particularly the book of Deuteronomy, it declares there that death would have been appropriate punishment for infidelity. And seemingly in this case, Joseph would have had the right to have had Mary stoned to death. However, and thanks be to God, by the time that Jesus was coming into the world, it appears that some of those religious requirements were beginning to soften just a little bit. And really, soften is probably not the correct word, because it was replaced with something else. It was. But the punishment of death was replaced with a formal public renunciation of the woman. It was replaced with this ritual that would have shamed Mary and her family for the rest of their lives. Sure, it wasn't death, but it still wasn't cool. So the old rules were explicit. They were explicit about young girls soon to be married that turn up with child. Now, we don't know very much about good old Joseph. Many suspect, and there are a lot of suspicion out there about Joseph, that he died likely before the time of Jesus' public ministry. Now, we do read that Jesus was referred to as the carpenter's son, at least on one occasion. So it does seem as if Joseph's involvement did extend past the time of the gospel stories. And it appears that at least somebody remembered him along the way. Somebody looked at that baby Jesus and saw something of Joseph in him. But what exactly, it's hard to say. But our lesson does raise at least one thing. It suggests one thing about Joseph's personality. And maybe you heard it already as I read the gospel lesson. See if you hear it again. Because when Mary is found to be with child, the gospel says Joseph, her husband, was a righteous man. Because he didn't want to humiliate her, he decided to call off their engagement quietly. Joseph is just. Joseph is righteous. Okay, but didn't we just say then the legal thing, the righteous thing for him to do, a man in his situation, was to renounce his fiance in public, a public shaming? Yes, we did. I just said that. And so what we need then to see and understand is that Joseph was in fact a man who colored inside the lines. As the Living Bible puts it, Joseph was a man of stern principle. Joseph was a man who was committed to his faith. He was committed to following the Torah and Torah law. And where those laws were explicit, for a man like Joseph, that meant there was a path of duty to follow. There was a path of righteousness that must be followed, and that was explicit too. But here's the thing. Curiously, even before the angel of the Lord came to Joseph in a dream, Joseph resolved to bend those expectations and to act really in the face of everything that his time and his place and his station in life had taught him to do when he met with the unexpected. Joseph resolved to stand aside quietly and to leave Mary and her family with their dignity intact. So he doesn't do what would have been expected. Instead, he follows this pull of something else and being righteous, and yet even so, he was unwilling to put Mary to shame. Joseph hears the call of something that is deeply countercultural for a man in his position. And what is so remarkable about him is that he had the wisdom and he had the courage to follow that call and feel that pull. I mean, let's be real, right? Let's be real. Joseph did not know that Christmas was coming. He didn't know that Christmas was next Sunday. He didn't get that. He didn't hear on the radio, "It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas." No, he didn't hear, "It's the most wonderful time of the year." No. But if you ask me, he did hear the call of Advent just the same. Joseph heard the call of Advent. It's quiet, it's insistent longing for a world to follow different rules, a world that seeks to live in the light of great promises and which no longer is trapped by familiar expectations. Joseph heard Advent's invitation to live a life in which at last love dares to speak its name. And somehow in that moment, he knew that love's name was the only thing that really mattered. This morning's Christmas story doesn't go on and tell us about the role that Joseph played in the life of young Jesus. We don't know if Joseph even lived long enough to teach Jesus about his trade, about his carpentry, much less than anything else. But we do know that the love that Jesus talks a whole lot about, the love that Jesus stood for, the love that Jesus came down to die for, was just that kind of rule-changing, deep-seeing kind of love. That kind of non-abandoning, instinctive, sheltering, protecting, guiding love. That kind of patient, quiet, healing love that dwelled deeply inside his earthly dad. Love that was strong enough to grasp for something different, undeterred by conventions or expectations or limitations. You see, that's the love of Jesus. That was the love of his father, Joseph. That's the love of our God. That's the love that came down at Christmas. the light in the darkness to God. Glory on high. In all the years since the lead up to that very first Christmas day, we have surrounded, you and I, we have surrounded the season with so many expectations of our own. And you can tell your own stories, you know, but maybe it goes something like the family gathers, has to be at a particular time, our good humor is invited, but our worry is not. The person that we were before gets invited, but the person that we've become doesn't get invited. Our children are invited, but their energy is definitely not. The time that we spent searching for that absolutely perfect gift is matched by that 11th hour. Oh, gee, it's just something to open, kind of shrug of a present in return. I mean, no wonder that many of us, what we really want for Christmas is that nap. But Advent invites us to let go. To let go of all those expectations. Advent calls us to remember the love of Jesus, the love of Joseph, the love of God. It calls us to let God's peace gradually warm our souls, freeing us for new expectations and for the birth of something within us and for us, the arrival of Emmanuel, God with us, born unto us this day in the city of David. A Savior who is Christ the Lord. Advent calls us, friends, to wait for this arrival of hope and to see the shadowy outline of a new world that is just beginning to dawn. For Joseph, to hear the call of God's love was the dawn of a distinctively countercultural vision. And the Christmas that lives in the hearts of us remains profoundly countercultural too. For at its core, Christmas is foreign to everything about us. Except for the power of our capacity to love and to be loved. And it is a bold claim that in the end, it's our capacity to love and to be loved that is the most important thing that matters. My friends, in these final days before Christmas morning, I don't know what kind of different music you're going to yet encounter as you go about finishing your preparations. But underneath it all, underneath all the music, underneath all the presents under the tree, underneath all the rushing and the bustling, may you all hear the quiet hymn that is God's great love song to you and to us all. Love has come and never will leave us. Life is life, everlasting and free. Love, love, love is the gift of Christmas. Love, love, Jesus Emmanuel. Friends, may the Christ child and the love that comes at Christmas strengthen you to follow love's call with joy and with purpose, letting go of everything else. Let every heart in this sanctuary prepare him room. Prepare room for love to be born there this Christmas. To the glory of God and all God's people said, Amen. Let us stand and affirm our faith with the Advent affirmation. We believe in God, creator and lover of the earth, origin and destiny of us all. We believe in Jesus the Christ, God coming to us in the fragile promise of a baby yet unborn, who emerges as the herald of hope, God's laughter in the face of despair. Plunged into death and hell, he broke free the captives and is leading the way to the land of promise where justice and peace will flourish. We believe in the Holy Spirit who implants the seed of truth, brings us to birth as the body of Christ, and empowers us to confront and transform all that is corrupt, degrading, and deceitful. We believe in the coming reign of God. It is drawn near to us in Jesus and will commence in the glorious marriage of earth and heaven, when all who have passed through the world's deep sorrow will be raised from the waters, robed in righteousness, and gathered into the joyous fulfillment of God's desire. For the coming of that day, on this day, we work and pray. Come, Lord Jesus, come. Let us sing together, Go Tell It on the Mountain, number 29. The love of God. May you know the salvation of our Savior. May you know the fellowship of the Holy Spirit this week that leads to Christmas. With my permission, please let some of those expectations go and prepare your heart for love to be born at Christmas. Go in peace. Amen.